Hare Krishna. I'm grateful to be here amongst all of you today evening. And thank you for coming. Am I audible clearly behind?
Yes.
Okay. So as is mentioned, I'll speak today on the topic of to blame is to be lame. I'll speak this based on the Bhagavad Gita, especially its analysis of the three modes. In the 18th chapter, Krishna talks about knowledge in the three modes of material nature. He talks about knowledge in goodness, in passion, and in ignorance. I'll explain what these modes are a little later, but let's look at what knowledge in ignorance refers to. Yattu kutsnavade kasmin karye saktam ahaitukam atattvarthavadalpamcha tattamasamudharatam. This is 18.22 in the Gita, where Krishna is saying this is knowledge in ignorance. Now, normally we think of knowledge and ignorance as two opposite things. So what do we mean by knowledge in ignorance? What it means is, it is the knowledge that actually increases our ignorance. Knowledge doesn't actually increase our understanding, it deepens our misunderstanding. That is knowledge in ignorance. And what is it characterized by? Yattu krutsnavat ekasmin. That yattu krutsnavat. One thing we take, ekasmin. Take it into everything. This one thing is all that is. Yattu krutsnavat ekasmin. Kare saktam ahaitukam. Kar, one comes irrationally attached without understanding proper cause and effect. Atattvarthavad alpamcha. Atattvarthavad. One does not have understanding of truth. But what does one have? Alpamcha. One has meager knowledge. So when one works in such a way, when the knowledge one acquires in this way is called knowledge in the mode of ignorance. So, after I started practicing bhakti, so a few years after that, I fell very sick. And I was in Pune and I was admitted to the hospital over there. And somehow that hospital, there was some medical mess over there. Some of the doctors were on strike or something like that. And I had a minor flu. And in the hospital, I got TB. So, normally you go to the hospital to get cured. But after going to the hospital, I got infected. And I got TB over there. And I already my immunity was very low, so TB just advanced very rapidly. And initially I was so furious. I was angry at the doctor, I was angry at the devotee who recommended the doctor. I was angry at the people who said, we could have gone to any other hospital, why did I have to go to that hospital? And I was so much angry at that time. And at one moment, it was Krishna's mercy. I just felt, what is the use of blaming anyone now? What is the use of blaming anyone? Let me just focus on the treatment. Now, we all understand this at an intellectual level, but somehow, by Krishna's mercy, at that moment, that thought sank into me. And I can still remember, it was almost like a liberating moment. Till that time, I was just carrying this burden of anger, burden of irritation, burden of resentment, burden of blaming others. And it's not just blaming others also. I was blaming myself also. You know, I could have thought that doctor, I knew there was something, things were not so good in that hospital. I could have chosen to go to some other hospital. But when I decided to stop blaming, it was like a liberating moment. And one thing that stimulated that for me, it is not consciously that this stimulated that, but Krishna consciousness works at subtler levels also. In the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, there is the incident of the cow and the bull being persecuted by Kali. And at that time, Kali is masquerading as a king and is tormenting, hitting the bull. So Parikshit Maharaj comes there and as the protector of Dharma, he's furious. Now before punishing Kali, he turns towards the victims to take their testimony. And he asked the bull, please tell me, what is the cause of your suffering? Now at one level, this question itself is ridiculous. You saw this person was beating me. Why are you asking me the cause of my suffering? Isn't it obvious? But the bull's reply also seems equally puzzling. The bull replies, actually, determining the cause of suffering is extremely difficult. Some people say it is because of our own past karma. Some people say it is because of destiny. Some people say it is because of the nature of this world. Some people say that it is just an illusion created by the mind. In this way, understanding the cause of suffering is very difficult. And as if this two interactions were not confusing enough, what Parikshit Maharaj replies seems to be even more confounding. He says, bravo, that one who blames another for one's own suffering attains the same destination as the causer of the suffering. That means, he says, if the victim blames the victimizer and the victim has the same destination as the victimizer. Now what does this mean? How is this possible? You know, if one person beats up another person and the second person points out, he beat me up. Are they both going to get the same destination? It doesn't seem to make any sense at all. But to make sense of it, we have to understand the whole context of the Bhagavatam. The Bhagavatam itself is actually taking us beyond immediate causes. Sometimes we have some adventure movies in which, say, the hero is there, maybe some Indiana Jones movie or something like that, where, you know, he has to get to a particular thing. If he doesn't get it in time, then he will be killed, everyone will be killed. So it's a race against time to get there and get that treasure or get whatever it is and save it. Otherwise he's going to die. So Parikshit Maharaj at the start of the Bhagavatam is cursed to die in 7 days. And after 7 days, he dies. So what is the story? I wonder if sometimes this is a movie, and the movie starting is person is cursed to die, and at the end of the movie, person dies. What is going on over here? What is special about it? So the Bhagavatam's vision is that actually things happen at multiple levels. So at the material level, Parikshit Maharaj dies. But is it that the Lord who protected Parikshit Maharaj when he was in his womb, when he was in his mother's womb, that Lord forsook him later? No. That Lord protected him at that time also. And he protected him how? By manifesting as the Bhagavatam. The Bhagavat Katha gave him shelter at the spiritual level. And the acharyas describe that Sandashtam, that Sarpa Sandashtam, the snake came and bit him. Parikshit Maharaj had already left his body. He had already gone to the spiritual world. So it was not that the curse killed him. It was rather the hearing of the Bhagavatam delivered him. And the curse simply acted at the material level. And again, it's interesting, Parikshit Maharaj does not at all blame Sringi. Sringi is the Brahmana boy who is cursed for a minor infraction. But he doesn't hold him responsible at all. What does he do? He says, this is just an opportunity for me to turn towards Krishna and to take wholehearted shelter of Krishna. And saying this, he just renounces the world, focuses on hearing the Bhagavatam, and attains Krishna. So, if you look at how things happen in the world, now there are multiple levels of causation. Say, I got TB, I went to the hospital and I got TB. Now, there were many other people in the hospital, they did not get TB. Why not? There were two people in the same house, one of them gets malaria, the other doesn't get malaria. Now, Is it that the mosquito likes one person and dislikes another person? But the mosquito went and bit the one person and did not bite the other person? Sometimes two people may be twins. And they may be, their health may be more or less equal. But still one of them falls sick with some infection, the other doesn't fall sick. Why the difference? So actually, there is the immediate cause of things. But the immediate cause is not the only cause. The distresses that happen in our life, we can say that there are multiple levels of causes for them. The immediate cause is what we see. Okay, a mosquito bit me. A germ came into my body, that's why I got the infection. That's why I got the disease. That is the immediate cause. Beyond that is the remote cause. The remote cause is my own past karma. So two people are in the same house, their immunity is more or less equal, but one falls sick, the other doesn't fall sick. Why? Because the karma of both of them is different. And that the remote cause is also responsible for what happens. And beyond that is the ultimate cause. The ultimate cause of all distress is forgetfulness of Krishna. We are in this world disconnected from Krishna, and that's what puts us in all distress. We are souls who are parts of Krishna and are meant to be living happily with Him. So now, if you look at this is the thing that has happened. There's an immediate cause, remote cause, ultimate cause. The Bhagavatam's vision is that go beyond the immediate cause. So each scripture has its own mood. Bhagavatam's mood is to transcend the world. So transcend, the Bhagavad Gita's mood is also to transcend the world, but the Bhagavad Gita's stress is on transforming the world. Krishna tells Arjuna, you have to fight to establish dharma over here. So he wants to transform the world, change who is the ruler over here. But the Bhagavatam's mood is, yes, something is happening which is unavoidable now, just accept it and transcend the world. So basically, when we blame someone or something for the distress that comes in our life, we are focusing only on the immediate cause. This person did this because of which this happened. Now when we blame someone, we say, you did this because of this happened, or we blame ourselves. Now blaming others is bad, blaming ourselves is equally if not more bad. Why? Because ultimately, we are our only resource. We are our only resource. Whatever we want to do in our life, even if we want to seek someone's help, now it is I who have to take their help. So if we blame ourselves for our mistakes, I'll talk a little later, but there's a difference between blaming and finding out who is responsible. Or who or what is responsible. If we blame ourselves, that means we just like take a stick and beat ourselves. Beat ourselves. You fool, why did you do that? You are useless, you are hopeless, you are worthless, you are good for nothing. Now when we blame ourselves like that, we are beating ourselves up. By that we simply de-energize ourselves. We dishearten ourselves and we just can't do anything. We become emotional wrecks. And sooner or later, we also will become physical wrecks after that. Mm-hmm. So, if we are blaming ourselves, that is also very damaging. And if we are blaming others, then also it's damaging. Because that person did like this, that person did like this, that person did like this. Now, even if it is true that that person is the cause of this particular mess, but still, what do we practically get by blaming that person? It's okay, that person did that, but then it is whatever power I have to change the situation, as long as I'm holding that person responsible, I don't have that power. I'm just fixating on it. The whole world I won't recognize. You know, this person made the mistake, this person made the mistake, this person made the mistake. Okay, what are we doing to correct the mistake? What are we actually doing? So when we start blaming others, we disempower ourselves. Why? Because whatever power we have to change the situation, to improve the situation, instead of using that power constructively, we concentrate all that power on fixing the blame on the other person. Now, of course, as I said, that we have to, we live in a practical world, and sometimes who is responsible has to be recognized. But that can be done with proper knowledge. So there is knowledge in ignorance, there can be knowledge in passion, knowledge in goodness. Now, I'll take a little back step and explain what these modes actually are. The three modes of material nature, they are subtle forces that shape the interaction between matter and consciousness. The way we look at things, that is, we are conscious beings and the world is out there. So the way we look at things, that is shaped by the modes. So if we consider, for all our actions, there is contemplation internally and action externally. In goodness, sattva guna, there is contemplation first and action later. I think, okay, and then I decide and I do it. In passion, there is first action, then contemplation. So we could say that look before you leap. That is mode of goodness. There's a slogan of a shoe company, just do it. That is the mode of passion. So we could say some people speak to express their thoughts, and some people speak to discover their thoughts. They speak something, I didn't mean to say that, sorry. So we all have slips of tongue. How many of you have experienced some embarrassing slip of tongue at some time or the other? Yeah, it's just, it can be very embarrassing because we speak but we don't think what we are speaking. So when that happens, there is action is there, but the action comes before the speech. So that is the mode of passion. Now the mode of ignorance is where there is neither contemplation nor action. There is simply delusion. Simply, oh, this may happen, this happened like that, that went like that, that went like that. Krishna describes these characteristics in 14.11, 12 and 13. In 14.11 he says, the characteristic of the mode of goodness is prakasha. Prakasha means illumination. Sarvadvareshu deheesmin prakasha upajayate. When there is illumination, say this door is dark, you don't know who is coming in, who is going out. But if the door is lit, we can see who is coming in, who is going out. And we can decide, if a child is slipping out, no, don't let the child go out. If a thief is coming in, don't let them come in. So like that, if our doors of senses are illumined, that means we can contemplate, analyze and decide what should come into our body, and what should we should perceive and what we should express. But in the mode of passion, lobha pravrittirarambha karmanama shamah spruha rajasyetani jayante vivruddhe bharatarishabha pravritti. One is impelled to act. I have to do something right now. Just can't think much. I have to do something. And in the mode of ignorance, 14.13 says aprakasho apravrittischa pramado maha evacha tamasyetani jayante vivruddhe kurunandana. There is neither prakash, neither illumination, or prakash, nor action, or pravrittish. What is there? Pramado moha evacha. There is madness, intoxication, and illusion. So one is just, hey, this will, this happened like that, that happened like that, that happened like that. One is just living in the head, imagining things, not doing anything at all, practical. Just daydreaming or lamenting, resenting. That is in the mode of ignorance. So some people make things happen. They plan, okay, you do this, I do this, we'll do this together. They are the mode of goodness. Some people watch things happen. They are the mode of passion. They try to do one thing, but it's like one thing, they don't plan so well. So one thing leads to second and third, fourth, hey, what's happening? Some people make things happen, some people watch things happen, and some people wonder what happened. So people in ignorance are just lost in their own head. They don't even know what is going on around them. So these three modes shape how we look at things. So broadly we could say that Now, when we live in the world, there is something which is in our control and something which is not in our control. So in the mode of passion, we are so much eager, we have so much zeal to do things that in the mode of passion, we tend to overestimate our capacity to control things. In the mode of ignorance, we underestimate our capacity to control things. So for example, if some mistake has happened, some mess up has happened, in the mode of ignorance, so nothing can be done, you know, nothing can be done. And you just give up, and just, only thing I can do is, okay, let me not be blamed for it, let somebody else be blamed for it. We look for a scapegoat for it. So in the mode of passion, in the mode of ignorance, we look for a scapegoat because we don't feel anything can be done practically. In the mode of passion, we look for power. No power. You know, if I get more power, I'll prevent such things from happening future. But in the mode of goodness, we look for insight. We look for understanding. We try to properly understand what is in my control, what is not in my control. So in the mode of passion, some people may think, whatever problem is there, just throw money at it, you can solve the problem. No, get the right contacts, get more power, you'll be able to fix the problem. So now, yes, at one level, if we have if somebody has a disease, then if we have medicines, if we have money to buy the medicines to take the treatment, we can be cured. But some diseases are incurable. So money is important, power is important, but it alone cannot fix all problems. In the mode of passion, we think, yes, we want a quick fix. Just throw this at this problem and solve it. Now, with respect to problems, the modes shape how we perceive things. And that's why when we are affected too much by the mode of ignorance, then we feel there's nothing that I can do about it. And then we just try to fix the blame on someone. This person did like this, this person did like this. So by this, we disempower ourselves. Just like if somebody becomes lame, then they can't walk. Similar to blame is to make ourselves lame. We just disempower ourselves, we lose the capacity to do anything. Now going back, to the earlier discussion of three-level causation, immediate cause, remote cause and ultimate cause. So in the mode of ignorance and in the mode of passion, more or less we see only the immediate cause. But in the mode of ignorance, we feel the immediate cause is so powerful, so overwhelming that nothing can be done about it. In the mode of passion, we see the immediate cause, I'm going to fix this. And we use all our energy to fix the immediate cause itself. So, in the mode of ignorance, we will just passively blame, you know, find a scapegoat, but passively blame someone. You know, this person is responsible, this person is responsible, this person is responsible. In the mode of passion, also we may blame someone. But then it will not just be passively blaming. It will be actively seeking vendetta. No, it will be, I will take revenge against this person. I will destroy this person. No. In Hindi they say, tum share to mai sawa share. You know, if you beat me twice, I will beat you thrice. So the idea and mode of passion is that we want to not only fix blame on someone, but we actually want to take revenge against them. So in mode of goodness, we try to understand it and things more holistically. We try to gain proper understanding. So what is this proper understanding? That the immediate cause is important. But the immediate cause alone doesn't determine everything. It's a simple example. Nowadays, all of us practically are concerned about, because our lifestyle is so sedentary, the food tends to be so fatty, we all worry that we may get overweight. And now some people, their bodies are such that they eat a little bit extra, immediately their health gets spoiled, their body balloons up. And some people, they treat their tongue like a conveyor belt. they take everything, they eat everything and everything, and nothing seems to happen to them. They still say healthy, they still fit. So, that the two people may eat the same food, but the consequence will be entirely opposite. Now, why is it that if there is a law of karma, there is action and reaction? So, why this big reaction to this person and no reaction to the other person? That's because law of karma is not simply a linear connection between action and reaction. Law of karma, there is action which leads to reaction. But in between action and reaction is also our past karma. Our past karma determines whether the present karma will give a big reaction, a small reaction, or no reaction. Say, how does it work? Some people, by their past karma, are meant in this life to have a sickly body. And some people, by their past karma, in this life, are meant to have a healthy body. So then, somebody who is meant to have a sickly body, a small mistake on their part, immediately the body's vulnerability comes up and they fall sick. Somebody else, they're meant to have a healthy body. So they subject the body to all kinds of disorderly conduct, even abuse, but the body stays healthy. Why? Because that past karma comes in between the present karma and its reaction. Sometimes it may also happen that the present action is just a stimulus or a trigger for the past karma to provide a reaction. Like say water has fallen over here. Now, three of us may walk along and two of us may just walk by the water and one of us may walk on the water, slip and fall. Now, why did one person slip and fall? Now, actually all three may be talking with each other. So, none of them was looking at the floor. So, if you want to say being inattentive, all three were inattentive. But only one person fell over there. Or sometimes it may be that two people may fall down, but one person may just get a bump and the other may get a fracture. Why the difference? So in this case, the immediate cause is there. But the immediate cause is a trigger or an instrument for some remote cause to act. So for somebody, there was no remote cause over there. There's no karma whose reaction is going to come over there. So then, they just walk over the water, they just slip a little bit, they pull themselves and balance themselves. Somebody else slips and falls flat. So the immediate cause is not the complete cause. Sometimes it's just simple. You know, I get a sore throat, why? Because yesterday night I ate ice cream or too many ice creams. Again, I get a cold or whatever. That's a simple thing to understand. So the law of karma can work in different ways at different times. Sometimes a small incident may just have a small reaction. Small action may have a small reaction. Sometimes a small action may have a big reaction. Sometimes converse may also happen. A big mistake may have no reaction also. Now, when I do program in colleges, many times students say, oh, I studied so much, but you know, I didn't get good marks in my exam. So then if I know the students well, I ask them, can you think of the times when you didn't study much, whatever you studied came in the exam and you got good marks? That also happens to us. So, sometimes we just do little good, but we get a lot of result by that. So, karma, our past karma, also affects the connection between present cause and present effect. Why are we talking about this? So, if a particular mistake has happened, we have landed in a particular mess, and some person has done something because of which we landed in that mess. Now, is that person responsible? Well, yes. But is that person completely responsible? Not necessarily. The modern material vision focuses, or we can say almost obsesses, on dealing only with the immediate cause. And dealing with the immediate cause is also important. If I go back to the starting conversation of between Parikshit Maharaj and the bull, what is the cause of your suffering? So now, what is Parikshit Maharaj asking by this? You can obviously see the cause, the immediate cause of suffering is this attacker. But Parikshit Maharaj is not asking that. He is testing the, and he's already has a sense that this is no ordinary bull. So, therefore, he wants to know who this bull is. And that's why he asks the question. What is the cause of your suffering? And then it goes back, there's the immediate cause. Neither of them are talking about the immediate cause. They're talking about the remote cause. So, what is the remote cause? It's very difficult to know. Okay, you can say my own karma, but what karma? When did I do it? Why is that karma coming now? It's very difficult to know that. So remote cause is very difficult to know. And then, when Parikshit Maharaj replies that the victim will get the same distinction as the victimizer, if the victim blames the victimizer, what does it mean? It doesn't mean karmically both of them are equally culpable. It means simply that both of them will stay in the same ignorant material consciousness. The victimizer is thinking, this person, if I just punish this person, if I just exploit this person, then my plans will be successful. They're just looking at the immediate cause. And the victim, this person did this. Then the victim is also staying in the same material consciousness. So in that sense, both of them will stay in spiritual ignorance. In the Ishopanishad, it says, Andham tamah pravishanti ye vidyam upasate tato bhuya ivate tamo ya uvidya yamrataha. It says those who are in ignorance, they will go into the darkness. But those who are in so-called knowledge, they will go into deeper darkness. Why? Because they think they know when actually they do not know. So similarly, when I think I know this person is the cause of my misery, then actually I am presuming to know when I actually don't know. And therefore, I will complicate the situation. In hitting back at that person, I will only start, a hate saga. Where I hate this person and that person hates me. Many times, sometimes in dynasties, this goes on, Your grandfather did this to my grandfather. And therefore, your father did this to my father. And therefore, I am doing this to you. This goes on generation after generation after generation. So when we function in the world, especially if we are in the mode of goodness, in the mode of passion, we just want to address the immediate cause, either blame the immediate cause and feel helpless, or hit back at the immediate cause and think we have done the work. But when we come to the mode of goodness, then we see the deeper picture. We see beyond the immediate cause to deeper causes. Sarva bhuteshu yenaikam bhavam avyamikshate avibhaktam vibhakteshu tadjnanam vidyasatvikam. Krishna says that when we see beyond matter to spirit, when we see the one imperishable spirit existing in all living beings, our knowledge is in the mode of goodness. So how does this apply practically for us now? If I want to see in a mode of goodness, and if I should not blame others, then what should we do? See, there is some mess that has happened, and we want to correct the mess at this level, at a practical level. Now for correcting, there are different ways to correct. If somebody as an immediate cause is responsible, then that can be pointed out. Okay, I did this, they did this, and this is what happened. Okay, I might have made some small mistake, they made a big mistake. But rather than blaming, the focus is on learning. Learning means what? Learning not just specifically, okay, how we can do this better. That's also one thing to learn. But learning also about the nature of the world. Sometimes, just things go wrong. And whenever something goes wrong, at that time it appears as if this is catastrophic. It's just this has gone wrong. My life is shattered by this. But if you look at the mind, you could say like a The mind is like a drama queen. some people are so dramatic. One thing has happened, some kids, they'll call mommy, mommy, and start screaming. So what has happened? You know, some small thing has happened, they scream as if the whole world is shattered now. So, like that, the mind takes some problem. And now if we look back at our life, maybe now we may have some problem which we feel, like this problem is not solved, my life is going to go to, I'm going to be shattered. But if you look back, if you can think objectively, 1 year ago, also there might be some other problem. 5 years ago, there might have been some other problem. 10 years ago, there might have been some other problem. So, at each time in our life, there has always been some problem which our mind told this is going to ruin your life. Yes, we all survived those problems. Some problems have scarred us more, some problems may have scarred us less. They make some scars on us, but we have survived them. So the mind tends to catastrophize problems. Oh, this problem is so big, it makes it much, much bigger than what it needs to be. So when the mind catastrophizes problems, the intelligence needs to contextualize the problems. Contextualize means see them in a bigger context. That it is not just this person causing this, but okay, this person has done this, but this person's action is simply the immediate cause. Beyond that, there are remote causes also. So now, what are we meant to do? Bhakti Siddhanta said, how do we, if there is some problem that is there, somebody has done something which is wrong, so what do we do about it? Bhakti Siddhanta Thakur wrote an essay. It was like the first, we could say, first writing that he wrote, first book that he wrote, explaining philosophy. That was called Bangale Samajikta, Sociality in Bengal. And that time he was responding to Western British criticism of India, saying Indians are so passive. They just don't do anything. They don't work hard, they have no zeal, no ambition. It's so passive. If things go wrong, they just passively accept what is wrong. So, this is a common criticism that Indian culture is very fatalistic. Some Britishers would say that the way if famines occur, if droughts occur, if this happened in our country, there will be mutiny. But Indians just passively tolerate it. So, Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur says that actually, we as souls interact with the world in two different ways. One is through our Jnanendriyas and the other is through the Karmendriyas. Through the Jnanendriyas, through the senses by which we acquire knowledge, we observe, analyze and understand. Through the Karmendriyas, we act to change things. So he says that the definition of success of Western civilization and Indian civilization is different. That in Western civilization, expertise in karmendriyas is considered to be a sign of progress and success. How much change can you do in the outer world? In the Indian civilization, he says, expertise in jnanendriyas is considered to be a sign of progress and success. That means observe the world, try to understand the world, get more insight. So gaining more insight into the nature of reality is considered more important. Whereas in the Western civilization, changing things is considered more important. So that's why he says, by these two perspectives, hey, if you look from the Western perspective at India, you'll feel, why are these people so passive? Why didn't they do anything at all? So now both these are important. Now it's not that Indian civilization was not good at Karmendriyas. Arjuna was an archer, he was a champion archer, and he fought for Krishna also. But it's a relative emphasis. So if the emphasis becomes excessive only on Jnanendriyas, just observe, analyze, learn, that is good, but that if it taken to excess, it can lead to passivity. It can lead to fatalism. Fatalism means everything is destined. Nothing is in my hands. So some people say, "Meri kismati phooti hai." You know, my destiny is rotten. What can I do? Oh, well, actually, everything is not destined. We always have free will, and we can make positive changes. So if we go too much to the extreme of just passively tolerating, that can enable abuse of your behavior also, because people can exploit. But the other extreme is when we focus on fixing all problems, changing. You know, this is a problem, change this. This is a problem, change this. This is a problem, change this. The result of that is that there is very little capacity to tolerate, and there is very little capacity to commit. Because the whole idea is, if this doesn't seem to be working, change it. And that's how, that's one of the main reasons why relationships are not stable. Now, if a particular relationship is not working, just change it. People just break marriages, and people just break relationships. So when there is excessive emphasis on change, that also becomes a problem. Then there is no steadiness. There is no commitment. So both ways, it can be a problem. Now, going from external speaking, externally the mode of goodness and the mode of ignorance look very similar. Isn't it? Why? Because as I said earlier, in goodness, there is first contemplation, then action. In passion, there is first action, then contemplation. In ignorance, there is neither contemplation nor action. But externally speaking, a person in passion will be active. A person in ignorance and a person in goodness will be inactive. So now, say, who is in ignorance and who is in goodness? Now, two people may be sitting and hearing a class. Now, one person may be motionless because they are so absorbed. The other person is motionless because they are so lost. So, externally, goodness and ignorance can appear very similar. So actually, the traditional Indian culture was based on goodness. Don't try to fix things so much. Don't try to change things so much. Try to tolerate. Try to learn. Try to grow internally. But you could say that if goodness is not understood properly, then goodness and ignorance can become very similar. And there can be external tolerance with internal growth. Or there can be external inactivity with internal delusion. I'm not doing anything, but internally I'm not learning anything. So I'm tolerating sometimes because I want to grow in my life. But sometimes I'm just resenting. I'm not doing anything externally, but I'm not growing internally also. So here the idea which I'm moving towards in this discussion is that when some mistake happens, so if we just fix in the more, if you just, you are responsible for this, or you beat somebody up, that is not good. We have to try to see, okay, this situation happened, what can I learn from it, how can I rectify this? And sometimes rectifying may require changing the externals. Sometimes rectifying may require tolerating the externals. Sometimes some person may have done something wrong, but you know, that relationship may be more important for us. That situation may be a little sensitive situation. Okay, you know, even if that person, my purpose is not just identifying you are to be blamed for this. My purpose is, okay, how can this thing move on? How can we rectify the situation? How can we improve the situation? That is the purpose. You know, our love for Krishna should free us from the need to prove that we are right in every situation. If there is an ego battle going on, you know, you are wrong, I am right. That's how it will be. But if there's a loving relationship between two people, yeah, okay. I don't have that egoistic insecurity because of which I have to prove myself right in this situation. Okay, even if you have this understanding, fine, let's move on with life. If it is something not very important, then it's okay. So, for rectifying the issue, identifying the specific cause of the problem or pinpointing the blame on someone is not very important, then just move on with life. Sometimes it happens that we may be blamed for something which we have not done, but sometimes we also get credit for things which we have not done. So, this is how our present actions and our past actions play together. So that's why rather than simply trying to fix the blame on someone, we focus on what is important. What is important? So, Prabhupada writes in the 10th chapter of the Bhagavata purport that intelligence means to see things in their proper perspective. To see things in their proper perspective means to see what is more important and what is less important. So, a simple example to illustrate this. Say, if we are going in a crowded local train in Mumbai, the train's capacity is 50, but there are 200 people over there. So, everybody is squeezed. And some people just like to be bossy. So, the person we are standing and the person standing next to us starts pushing us. We get angry. How dare you push me? You push me, I'll push you back. And I start pushing back. And they start pushing us. We start pushing them. And we get so caught in pushing each other that our station comes and goes and we start pushing each other. That is ridiculous. Okay, the person wants to show off their power. Okay, you push, just move a little bit aside. It's just a short distance. Why bother about it? So, sometimes some issues are not very big, but we make them big. So life is meant for much bigger things than pushing back people who push us. So, if my purpose is clear, I have to get to this destination. And for that purpose, okay, this person is just being bossy. I'm not going to be in this train for a long time. Sometimes, if our purpose is clear, we understand this is not so important. So, there are many times if we recognize the purpose and focus on the purpose, then tolerating becomes easier. Tolerance simply means keeping small things small so that we can focus on big things. Tolerance means keeping small things small so that we can focus on the big things. Yeah, this person pushing me, it's a small thing. The important thing is I have to get to my destination. Now, is there a limit to tolerance? Yes, certainly. If that person starts pushing me out of the train only, then I can't tolerate that. Then I have to take a stand. So, if that person's actions start obstructing my purpose itself, then I have to take a stand. If they don't allow me to do my purpose at all, then I have to oppose. I have to take a stand. I have to do something actively to counter it. So, if in every relationship, in every situation, if I focus on, okay, I'm here, I'm in different relationships, different situations, different interactions, ultimately my purpose is to grow towards Krishna. And for going towards Krishna, I do need a certain level of harmony, a certain level of facilities. So, if that is going a little up or down, it's okay. No need to make a big issue out of it. But if somebody's actions are troubling us so much that we just can't do anything, that we are not able to chant, we are not able to be peaceful, we can't do anything, we are getting very agitated by their actions, then we may have to create some distance. We have to create some arrangement by which we create a buffer so that their actions don't affect us so much. So now it's not necessarily wrong to point out who is responsible for particular things. Sometimes we all need to learn, and if some debacle has happened, okay, this person did this and that's how it happened. So, but the point over there is that the success is not pointing out who is responsible. The success is how to get this thing moving again. How to make sure, so if some person is making the same mistake again and again and again, and then that is creating same kind of problem again and again and again. Then maybe it means, you know, they are not really meant for this service. They can serve in some other way. And pointing that out can be done in a mood of service. We all have our strengths and our weaknesses. So when, instead of blaming in an objective way, in a cultured way, we explain this is what happened and this is how this is happening, then there is a greater possibility that things can be resolved satisfactorily. So if we keep our purpose in mind, purpose is get this thing moved. I want to serve Krishna, I want to move this relationship forward, I want to move this project forward, I want to get this thing done. And what is the best way to do it? So generally when we blame, what is happening is we correct and condemn. Correct means we blame that person. You did this wrong, you did this wrong, and our focus is on you have to correct yourself. And condemn means we tell the whole world. We tell them you are wrong, that's correcting that person. And condemn means we tell the whole world. And by this, that person feels extremely hurt, that person feels infuriated, and they try to get back at us. But instead, if we focus on complimenting and complimenting. Compliment, this is complement, and complement. Compliment means to appreciate. Everybody has some good in them, and we appreciate that. And compliment, that means if they are deficient in something, then we make up for that. Rather than, hey, you can't do this, just see how well I can do it. Okay, I can do this better, let me take care of this, you take care of that. You don't get involved in this, I'll take care of this part. So if we focus on this, if in any relationship that we are working, any situation that we are working, if we just try to shift our focus on what is good in the other person, and we compliment that them for that, then they stop being so defensive. If my focus simply, you know, you are responsible for this mess, you are to be blamed, then their whole energy will be, no, I'm not. But the whole energy goes on, it shifts from the issue to just affixing the blame. But if we are appreciative of others, I say, okay, you know, then what happens is, the confrontation is not between you and me. It is, this issue is here, we have to deal with this issue. Yes, and if you deal with it in this way, it creates some problem. If I deal with it in this way, it might be better. So once we can shift the issue, rather than seeing the other person as an antagonist, as an opponent, we see we all have our conditionings, and rather than seeing that you are hurting me or that you are hurting, we see that we all are hurting under our conditionings. Everybody has their conditionings, and their conditionings hurt them, and sometimes they hurt others also. So if we see that we are all ultimately fighting against the same material nature, we are all subject to same material nature, I have certain defects, you have certain defects. So if we appreciate the good in others, we compliment, and what is their weakness, we try to make some arrangement as we make up for that. We take care of those things, we make some other means to take care of this. Then if we learn to compliment and compliment, many volatile or explosive situations can also be diffused. And that way, we can move forward more peacefully and more purposefully in our service to Krishna. So Srila Prabhupada said that, you know, your love for me can be shown by how you cooperate. Now cooperation, how will it happen if we are criticizing and condemning, if we are correcting and condemning? That will not lead to cooperation, that will lead to alienation. But if we learn to, now cooperation doesn't also mean, cooperation includes operation, isn't it? If somebody is not operating properly only, then how can you have cooperation? So we have to find out, how can this person operate well, what is that they can do, and what is it that I can do? And then that, when we do it, then we can move forwards properly. So then the mode of goodness, we learn to see things properly, okay? What is in my control, what is not in my control? Similarly, we learn to see what is in this person's control to change, what is not in this person's control to change. Because some conditions are just too difficult to change. It may take a long time, so then okay, this is something which they're not good at. Let them take care. Let them not get involved in that. Let somebody else take care of that. So that way, if we learn to compliment, then we'll be able to cooperate, we'll be able to diffuse volatile situations, and we'll find that our minds will and our lives will become much more peaceful. The internal friction within us and around us will go down substantially, and as the friction goes down, the devotion goes up. And because the friction goes down, then our mind becomes available for connecting with Krishna. Otherwise, the mind is completely consumed by this problem, this person, that person. So when our mind is available for connecting with Krishna, that is when bhakti becomes joyful. Because the more we connect with Krishna, then Krishna is sabasukha sagar, he is the reservoir of all happiness, anandmayo abhyasat. We connect with him, then we experience that bhakti is susukham kartum avyayam, it is joyfully performed. It is joyful to perform. So I'll summarize. I spoke today about to blame is to be lame. Stop seeking scapegoats. So I started by how Krishna says knowledge in the mode of ignorance means to say one thing to be everything. So we look at one cause and make that the complete cause. Sometimes it may be true that small issues lead to big. You go to the hospital to get cured, but you get a new disease over there. So it's naturally infuriating. But if you can stop blaming, it can actually be liberating. That burden of anger, resentment, it just crushes us. So how can we become liberated from this burden of blaming others? For that I talked about how knowledge in the mode of ignorance means we pursue one thing and make it everything. So in the whenever anything happens to us, there is the immediate cause, the remote cause, and the ultimate cause. The immediate cause is, say, I slip and fall. That immediate cause is somebody put water over there. The remote cause is, I had some karma, which because of the reaction, I fell and I got injured. The ultimate cause is forgetfulness of Krishna. So, if we obsess too much with the immediate cause, then not only do we say philosophically uninformed, we are not looking at the complete picture, but we are no longer available for fixing the ultimate cause, that is forgetfulness of Krishna. So we discussed about how the bull, Dharma says, Parikshit, that I don't know what the cause of my suffering is. Why? Because the Bhagavatam is not focusing on immediate causes and looking beyond those. Not even Parikshit Maharaj says, yes, it must be because of some karma where I have got this reaction. But his focus is on the ultimate cause. Let me absorb myself in Krishna and thus transcend this world. And Krishna protects Parikshit Maharaj even in this situation by manifesting as the Bhagavatam, which shelters him even before the snake bites him. In our life, when some mess happens, we want to, if we're in the mode of ignorance, I talked about goodness means first knowledge, first contemplation, then action. Passion means first action and contemplation. In ignorance, there's neither contemplation nor action, simply delusion. So in the mode of ignorance, we just want to fix the blame on someone and we feel sorry for ourselves. In the mode of passion, we want power. Power for what? Power for seeking vendetta. You get back at the person. You did this, that's why I'll do this. In the mode of goodness, we try to seek understanding properly. If we focus too much on the immediate causes, so the Indian civilization is focused more on remote cause. And just tolerate. This is your karma. Learn to tolerate it and move forward in life. Western civilization focuses too much on immediate cause and fixing that. Change. Now, because goodness and ignorance look very similar, so the tolerance, which is involving internal growth, can be mistaken to be impotence where there is nothing happening internally or externally. So tolerance doesn't mean passively accepting anything and everything. It means keeping small things small so that we can focus on big things. So for that we need intelligence to analyze what is a small thing and what is a big thing. So if we have a purpose for our life, just like in a train ride, when to just tolerate somebody pushing and when to push back. That depends on What is the purpose? So similarly for us, in the we may think we are in goodness, but we may go in ignorance. And somebody may think this person is ignorance, but they may be in goodness. So passion means change, and that leads to lack of tolerance and lack of commitment. And that leads to its own set of problems. So when we want to fix a mess, the important thing is not assigning blame. The important thing is moving forward and rectifying the situation. So our love for Krishna, our love for others should be big enough so that it frees us from the need to prove our rightness in every situation. We focus on how we can move forward. So instead of correcting and condemning others, our point is, let us compliment and compliment. If we see the good in them and speak their good, then they stop seeing us as antagonists, and rather than the battle between us and them, it becomes we battle against material nature. People are not hurting us, people are themselves being hurt by material nature's conditioning, and they, as a consequence, they are also hurting others. So if we appreciate the good in them, and then we make arrangement by which whatever is the limitation, that is taken care of, then we all can move forward much more cooperatively and much more joyfully. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So are there any questions or comments? Yes.
I just wanted to understand the immediate cause of what happened on 9/11. Can you please comment on that?
Okay.
Why did it happen? What was the immediate cause?
What was the
remote cause, and what was the ultimate cause?
Okay. What are the various levels of causation of what happened in 9/11? This is a question which will have to be asked to the Paramatma. But generally, when things happen in this world, we can always have various theories of why something happened. But broadly speaking, we have to act in a way that helps to rectify the situation. So if somebody is a victim of something, at that time it is not at all right philosophically or emotionally to focus on their culpability. If a thief has robbed a person and the victim of that robbery, person has been robbed, goes to the king and says, please help me. And the king says, it was your own karma because of which you are robbed. Well, what is the victim's karma is not important there. What is important is, what is the king's dharma? The king's dharma is to protect the citizens. So at one level, it can be said that if that happened, that money was robbed, it is the person's karma. But that is not the immediate thing. That is not the focus. The focus is the dharma of the king. Now, sometimes the king may try their best and still not be able to recover the money, catch the thieves. Then you can say, it was your karma that you lost the money. But otherwise, the king has to take action. So, we look at generally, the immediate and the remote cause, they don't have to be in competition with each other. When some immediate cause is assignable, then that immediate cause has to be looked at and has to be addressed. If somebody has got lung cancer and they have been smoking, the doctor has to tell you that you have to stop smoking if you don't want this cancer to work. But sometimes a person may never be smoking and still they get cancer. So those are exceptional situations. But generally, if an immediate cause is perceivable, so there are people who make religion into a means for fulfilling their own ego's ideas of gaining power, and they spout hatred. Last Sunday, I was in Washington DC, I spoke on this topic of, does religion cause war? So the, it is not religion that causes war, it is the modes in which people are. Religious people can, people, somebody can claim to be, I am a religious person, but they may be in goodness, they may be in passion, they may be in ignorance. So people in ignorance and passion, they will just act irrationally. So if some people have been victimized, then it is important that immediate causes need to be addressed at a practical level. So say greater security, greater addressing of the threats which are causing this, that is required. But then we may go deeper and look at what is the cause of this, why is this whole phenomena happening? So it is because of, Srila Prabhupada said that religion without philosophy is sentimentalism or fanaticism. So religion is a very powerful way of whipping up people's sentiments, and people can do irrational things when they feel that their religion is threatened. So for that, proper philosophical education is required. And now, what does that mean for us? That in every religious tradition, there are moderates and there are extremists. I have a Muslim friend who says that, now I can communicate better with moderates of other traditions than extremists of my own tradition. So it's like people who are in goodness in different traditions can talk with each other. A person in goodness and a person in ignorance, they just can't connect. So in general, for the world's well-being, we need to help raise the mode of goodness. So we ourselves, by our practice of bhakti, if we are coming more to goodness, and we try to help in creating structures by which those in goodness are encouraged and empowered, then the conflicts in the world will be addressed more effectively. Okay. Any other questions or comments?
Yes,
yes please.
In your example, like if a robber, the thief himself got hurt severely. So what? Yes.
If a thief got?
He got in a robbery. So what he has to do?
While robbing?
Yeah.
Okay.
In the US, he will sue.
Okay. If while robbing the thief gets hurt, what should the king do? Again, here, immediate factors have to be dealt at the immediate level. If somebody is hurt, somebody is injured, somebody is threatened, they have to be at, their physical wounds have to be addressed. And the idea is that if we have done some actions, we have to be held accountable for those actions. So there has to be a fair trial, and then after that, if the thief has robbed, the thief has to be punished. So it's not necessary that, you know, that one karma compensates for another karma. It's that, oh, the thief got injured while robbing. That injury is not the punishment for the robbery, because that injury is simply incidental or whatever it might happen. So karmas don't cancel out that way. So if we do good, the good results come. If we do bad, bad results come. So each of these two issues, they just occur simultaneously, but that doesn't mean that both of them have to be conflated. They have to be addressed separately. Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Yes, Prabhu, we'll come to you.
India got independence after 400 years of the British rule. So because of the Indian people are the mode of ignorance or mode of goodness, etc.
Okay. So India got independence from the Britishers after more than 200 years. So are Indians in the mode of goodness or in the mode of ignorance? Both are there. There are many thoughtful people in India. See, it's, you cannot put one label on any diverse group. So there are Indians in goodness, there are Indians in passion, there are Indians in ignorance also. So in general, India was a Brahminical land where a good number of Brahmins were there, and more importantly, by Brahmin, we're not looking at Brahmin by birth, but by quality. And more importantly, not just a large number of Brahmins were there, but the Brahmins were also empowered. They were facilitated, encouraged and empowered, by which they could positively influence society. If we consider the general mass of people, most people will be in the lower modes, passion and ignorance. To the extent those in goodness are empowered, to that extent they can guide the mode of in passion and ignorance constructively. To the extent those in goodness get disempowered, to that extent people act in mode and passion and ignorance, and they perpetuate the passion and ignorance, or when they perpetuate, they aggravate it. So overall, if we see when the Muslims ruled India for many, many years, for many centuries, many people converted, but the Brahminical structure more or less remained the same. That means that some temples were destroyed, all that, but the Brahmanas still were respected, and Hindus had their own society. But when the Britishers came, they had that intellectual appeal, because they had science and technology, they had Western science. So what happened was that Indian civilization felt intellectually challenged by the Western civilization. That there is no intellectual challenge felt because of Islamic civilization. So that intellectual challenge led to various effects. One was there was some school of Indians started demonizing everything Indian, in that everything Indian is the cause of our suffering, we just have to adopt Western things. Some Indians just became aggressive defenders who started saying that no, this is right, that is right. Some tried to integrate good from everything. But overall, the Brahminical structure, which was the spout of goodness, which is the source of goodness, that got disrupted. And that is why we can say that today a large number of Indians are in passion and ignorance. There are definitely some vestiges of culture because of which the passion and ignorance may not come out in entirely gross ways. But it does come out. But still the facility for goodness is there. There is some innate piety that is there in Indian culture. And if it is facilitated, it can grow quite fast. That answer your question? Thank you. Yes, please.
So my question is, if we're looking at our karma in this life and potentially what that would bring for any future lives, I mean, hopefully we're all going to God that we're not coming back, but just what can we do in this life in terms of cultivating good karma, good actions, from material level, mental level, emotional level, spiritual level, you know, let's say for example, you know, at a spiritual level, something like, you know, sankirtan or book distribution, things like this, you know, helping the temple, serving, you know, material level, just, you know, like good deeds, but what would you recommend are like the highest actions that we can make for ourselves to, for all of us to cultivate good karma?
Okay, yeah. So what actions can we do in this life so that we can create good karma and ultimately we attain Krishna? Basically, we are all in a diseased condition in this world. And when a patient is diseased, the most important thing is to take the curative medicine. But along with the curative medicine, if the patient is in great pain, then a pain-killing medicine is also given. And an expert doctor knows how to balance the pain medicine and the curative medicine. So the pain medicine is meant to mitigate the immediate pain, and the curative medicine is to ultimately heal it. So going back to the earlier analysis of karmendriyas and gyanendriyas, Western civilization focuses more and more on administering better and better pain medicine without even analyzing about the curative medicine. On the other hand, Indian civilization, especially you could say the monastic or the ascetic aspect of Indian civilization, it focuses on don't take any pain medicine. And then when you feel the pain, that will impel you to take the curative medicine more and more intensely. So the idea is, in the curative medicine alone, the pain medicine alone is counterproductive, because the disease is worsening internally, although one appears to be comfortable. That is how Western civilization right now is very comfortable at a physical level, but still there is distress at the mental level. Huge amount of suffering, mental health problems are skyrocketing. I say people in the Western world are comfortably distressed. Physically comfortable, mentally distressed. But the other extreme of taking only the curative medicine, that can become too unbearable for most people. So that's why Ishopisha said, Vidyam cha avidyam cha yastad vedo vayam sa avidyaya mrityam tirtha vidyaya amrita mashnute. That we need avidya. Avidya doesn't mean ignorance, it means knowledge about this ignorant material world, how to function effectively in this world. And vidya refers to the knowledge by which we can go beyond this world. So for us, Bhakti Yoga, the practice of Bhakti Yoga in terms of the core practices of Bhakti, chanting and studying scriptures, worshipping the deities, these are like the curative medicine. And we have to make sure that we keep taking those diligently. But at the same time, we have to live in this world also. And when we are living in, we have to, maybe many years we have to live, our children have to live, future generations have to live. So you want to also create systems by which the stay in this world is not unbearably painful. The world is going to be a distressful place, but our actions can make its distress worse, or it can be make it lesser. When Krishna says this world is dukkhalayam, that does not mean that he wants everyone to be miserable. Arjuna was in tears at the start of the Gita. At the end of the Gita, he was composed. His tears went away. So Krishna did not say, "Oh Arjuna, you are in tears. Now you are understanding this world is dukkhalayam. Stay dukhi. Stay distressed." No. So pain is a feature of the world, but pain is not the purpose of the world. It's like in a hospital, pain is there, but the purpose of the hospital is not to cause pain. The purpose of the hospital is to cure pain. So the world is like a hospital. So here, we need to have overall mode of goodness interactions. Our relationships should need to be in mode of goodness, so that at a physical level, there is a more orderly functioning. At a mental level, there is less agitation. So if we learn to deal with each other in a more cultured way, Bhagavad Gita says that austerity in the mode of goodness for speech means speak in a way that doesn't agitate others. Anudvega karam vakyam satyam priyahitam jayat. We speak in a non-agitating way with others. If you just learn this, so many of our interactions, they would become so much less painful. We have to speak the truth, but think, okay, how can I speak this in a way that will not hurt the other person so much? So if we learn that, then at a mental level, the agitation can go down. At a physical level, what can we do? We all have particular areas in which we work. We have been given certain talents. We use those talents to make a positive contribution. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, I long for the day when the high court judges will be wearing tilaks. That means there will be high court judges and will be devotees. Now, how is this going to happen? One way we could say is that in the future we have a devotee government, and the devotee government appoints devotees as judges. Well, that is possible, but that seems to be a very long way off. More realistically, it could be that devotees who are well educated, who are responsible, they become judges, or judges become devotees, and they do their work of judging so responsibly that they are appointed as in top-notch positions in society. So we have to also, whatever abilities Krishna has given us, we use them constructively in his service. And when we do that in an effective way, then that will also create positive perceptions about Krishna Bhakti among people in general. And even if they don't take up Krishna Bhakti, if they come at least to the mode of goodness by practicing some aspects of Krishna Bhakti, that will also make the situations less agitating and more conducive for harmonious living. So that's how we all can contribute to not just ensuring that our ultimate destination is auspicious, but our journey towards that destination is also as less agitating as possible. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. So,
thanks.
Okay. Yes. Do we have time, Mataji?
No, I think it is 9 o'clock.
Yeah, okay.
It is a working day.
Yes, sure.
And we have some prasadam downstairs. So I would recommend that those of you who would like to get some personal device, you can go.